on the...
Of Adobe?
Okay, it's 6:30. I'll call the Board of Selectmen's meeting to order for Monday, November 30th, 2015. Would you please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. As we start our meeting, I think most of you know, but I want to just point out, it's a very somber day within Town Hall and in the town of Harwich. We learned of the passing Saturday evening of Dave Scannell, unexpectedly, our town assessor. And I'd ask you just all, please take a moment of silence to consider all he contributed to this town and just reflect on his friendship and our colleague Dave Scannell. So just take a moment, please. Thank you. And I've asked Richard Waystack to, he has some announcements regarding this. So Richard, who is our chairman of the Board of Assessors. Richard.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Richard Waystack on behalf of the Board of Assessors. And I'm joined this evening by Donna Molina and Tammy Taylor of the Assessing Department. As Mr. Hughes said, it's a very, very heavy heart that we inform the community of the passing of David Scannell, Director of Assessing for the town of Harwich. If you didn't know, Mr. Scannell served this community for over 34 years and was the senior member of Town Hall. His expertise was widely regarded across Cape Cod, and he was considered the Dean of Assessors here on the Cape. He was a good friend to many. He was always willing to help his fellow employees, and he went out of his way to assist those taxpayers who were most in need in this community. We've been inundated with calls today asking about services for David, and the services will be as follows. Friday, December 4th, from 4 to 7 p.m. at Morris O'Connor and Blute Funeral Home, there will be calling hours. Saturday, December 5th, at 11 a.m. at the Harwich Community Center, there will be a service and reception in recognition of Dave's life. All of the community is welcome to attend. Dave was a good man. He served this community, he loved this community. And we ask for everyone's thoughts and prayers for his family and for his staff that he worked with very, very closely over these next few days. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Appreciate that. So because of that, we pulled a few things from the agenda tonight, just because I didn't think as chairman was appropriate. That we asked some of our town hall employees to make presentations and whatnot. So you'll see that under public comments and announcement, the Garden Club will reschedule that for next week. Also, the update on the Acela permitting software that Paul was going to do, we're taking that off the agenda. We'll get back to that either next week or the week after. So with that, we'll move on as we must. Weekly briefing. Anybody have anything on the weekly briefing? Link.
Good evening. Link Cooper, DPW Director. I have three items I'd like to brief the board on this evening. Before I begin, I'd like to tell you the first time I met Dave Scannell, very briefly. I was in grad school a little over a decade ago, and I had to do a practicum, and I did it on a financial analysis on the town of Harwich, which wasn't very good at that time. Part of that was to present a recap sheet, a recapitulation sheet. I don't know if anybody has tried to digest one. I'm sure the administrator has and the assistant administrator. But other than that, it's accountant speak is what it is. Dave, I knew who Mr. Scannell was at that time, came over, opened his office up, sat down, and spent a couple hours with me, unannounced, explaining this whole thing for me to, which was a futile attempt, most likely, but so I could at least write about it. And I was very appreciative of Mr. Scannell for that. I have three things I'd like to brief the board about. We'll start with the Downey property demo that you authorized that we took care of about 2 weeks ago, including the Arbor House garage that we removed in a doghouse. This project was a ways in the making. It started with, my end started when Mr. Clark invited me to a meeting they had, I think the day they passed papers or the day after they passed papers. And he says, when can you get this down? How much will it cost? Off the top of my head, I told him 10 to 12 grand, and I see a couple of days of work. Knowing the skill set we have at the DPW. When we had all the permits, which was really a town effort, I mean, we're talking about conservation, building, water, harbor. This was a lot of people involved, a lot of moving parts. When we finally had everything in place, that, as long as we're taking that over next to us here, was 2.5 days. And we did it for just under 10 grand. It's my belief if we were to outsource that, you'd probably be looking at a $30,000 to $40,000 effort. Price tag on that. A special thanks goes to Boo, Rich Berube, who managed the project, Dave Ridington, who was running the excavator and is absolutely amazing with that piece of equipment, Tom Yarborough, and Mike Medeiros was on the trailer dump. We did it in 2.5 days that we said we would, and I think everything went like clockwork. A lot of good preparation went into that. Any questions about, nope, move on.
I think, you know, all those areas look great. I mean, we had a lot of comments, I think, from people just saying, you know, how much they appreciated the effort, and it made a big difference in the appearance.
It certainly did, and benefited the town and the community at large. The second item you may or may not be aware of was we recently had issues with our scale at the transfer station. I saw the administrator about this issue about 6 weeks ago, 7 weeks ago, when we were getting it recertification on a scale, which is an annual outing. The Bouncable Weights and Measures comes, and a scale company come, and they put specific weights on it. Although we did get it calibrated, the scale company advised me, you're on borrowed time here. You've got very antiquated, old-style analog load cells that are no longer available. Our scale hadn't been touched since we had put it that new deck in 2003. And he says, you better look at this thing and take some attention to it. So I got some prices. I went and saw the administrator, and it turned out to be about $24,000 to purchase the new digital load cells, which there are 8 of them, a new instrument, the stuff to hook all of it up, and 3 days of the scale company's technician to assist us. The real labor and the expertise was pulling this whole deck apart, sandblasting it, fabricating it so that it could work with the new components, the new load cells, painting it, and getting it back in place in 3 days flat. Absolutely amazing. Again, Rich Berube, Boo, managed that project. That used to be my job when I worked over at the disposal area, but, you know, progress. Rich did a wonderful job at that. It was, at times, all hands on deck because we really needed that up. We couldn't go through a weekend without having the scale, a very vital piece of equipment. The contractors, we notified everyone we had accounts so that we know, and we made provisions for people to go to Robert Hour and weigh in and weigh out if necessary. So the business aspect saw very little interruption. The guys did a remarkable job. I invited Mr. Clark over one evening to see us as we were fabricating or painting the three separate sections. Went back in by clockwork. When it was going in, I asked the tech supervisor from the sale company. I said, how much would this thing be if we were outsource this? We said, just turnkey, just fix this thing. Without hesitation, he said, we just did one 2 months ago, was $65,000. Now, obviously, there's a sunk cost to our labor, and there's some things that did not get done. But basically, in 3 days, we saved that kind of dough for the town. And I could not be prouder of the guys that participated in that.
Yeah, Link, I think it's, you know, it's a team effort. And although, you know, Boo leads the team, if you will, for that effort, I think everybody, as you said, you had all hands on deck. They all rolled up their sleeves and got it done. So, you know, we're certainly appreciative of that town is. So.
Yeah, they did a wonderful job. Those are the types of projects that you kind of look forward to. I mean, you're always under the gun and on the crunch time, but I enjoyed managing those types of projects back in the day. The last thing I'd like to brief the board on is that we are doing a pilot project and installing a license plate camera at the scale house. The ultimate goal of this would be to alleviate disposal area stickers, the physical sticker. Reading the license plates would allow us to not have to issue people the sticker and eventually move a lot more of this business online. And plus, it's going to be far more accurate than one person sitting at the scale house can be. We're putting the camera up tomorrow. Again, this is a pilot project. We're in it for a few thousand dollars. If it works out as we anticipate, and this is kind of new technology, and not that the license plate recognition is all that new, and not that our database is new, melding the two in real time is the new aspect of this. We have an existing database we've been using for about 10, 12 years. We're going to get that to talk to the license plate software and say, Mr. Clark, you're authorized to come in. Ms. Charlene, you're not, sorry. Get a red light and stop or some function like that. I wanted to bring your attention because we're installing the camera tomorrow. We are, all the data that's going to be captured is going to be dumped daily. We're not retaining these plate images, and that's all it is doing. It's taking images of the plates and reconciling it against our database. Probably several months of trial before I'd be comfortable in coming in and rolling this out live for the season.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep. Okay. Anything else on the weekly briefing? Ginny?
Hi there. I'm Ginny Hewitt. I have a couple announcements from the library. Since the holiday shopping season has arrived, we wanted to remind residents that the library has an electronic subscription to Consumer Reports as well as the print subscriptions. So if you go to consumerreports.com, you can get a lot of free info, but when you start to get, you know, you click and you want more detailed info, they try to charge you a fee. So if you have a Brooks Free Library card, you don't have to do that. You do have to start at the library website. There's a link for electronic resources and pick Consumer Reports, and you enter your library card number, and then you can get all that free information. There's nothing worse than giving a gift and finding out it wasn't quality and it didn't last.
So Jenny, just for clarity, they have to do this at the library, or they can do it remotely?
No, from our website, which is brooksfreelibrary.org. Yep. We have the print copies too at the reference desk, but if you know, it's 2 a.m. and you're trying to think of what to get, you can look it up. And also for adults who might be thinking of giving or asking for electronics for the holidays, we're holding a technology show and tell this Saturday from 10:30 to noon. You can stop in and check out devices like e-readers and tablets and more while you're not under pressure from salespeople. So the librarians will be happy to provide you with the details about the devices, to look up reviews and price check local retailers. So no registration is required. That's just a drop-in session from 10:30 to noon. And also, we are participating this year again in Christmas in Harwich. This is the second year we're partnering with the Chamber and the Cape Destinations to offer a Polar Express on Saturday, December 5th. Sorry. Unfortunately, the event sold out within a few hours of being announced. So if you're watching, people watching this at home won't be able to get tickets. But it's a fundraiser that benefits the Chamber's Scholarship Fund. We're doing another event for Christmas in Harwich. Sunday the 6th, the Friends of the Library are hosting a concert by the Crabgrass Bluegrass Band. There's no admission charge, and they'll have some refreshments. It starts at 2, but you should come early because it usually fills up, and then we have to turn people away. And just two more things, sorry. This is the 16th year we've held a holiday fine amnesty and canned food drive in December to benefit the pantry. Last year we collected over 3,500 items. And so that's going to continue this December. If you owe any fines, just bring in some canned food or non-perishable items. And we clean up patron records, and it supports a great organization and helps others in the community. We are making a change, though. December is kind of a difficult time. The pantry gets overloaded with a lot of these canned food drives. And so it's a little hard to deal with the volume. So we're going to move our fine amnesty to the month of March next year. which will be a good time to help them restock after the holidays. But to ease the transition, we realized that this year people would be coming in and dropping off canned food anyway, so we're going to have to, you know, deal with that while people adjust. So we're doing it in December, and then we'll do it again in March, and then annually in March. And finally, I wanted to mention the Friends sponsor a Santa's annual visit to the library, and this year it will be Saturday, December 19th at 2 p.m. We'd like to thank Peter Letty, who arranged this year's visit, and Mr. Hughes, who filled in last year. Each child gets a chance to sit on Santa's lap and visit with him, and the Friends provide a small gift. So you have that to look forward to. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else for weekly briefing? Move on to public comments and announcements. Anything? Okay, we'll move on to the consent agenda. And let me just point out a couple things. Item B will not be taken up tonight. That's the assistant library director. And I know there are a question. There is a question or two on item E. So, Janelle, I'd ask you to consent agenda on A, C, and D, and then we'll talk about E.
Okay. Mr. Chair, I move that we A, approve minutes for 1, November 9th, 2015 regular meeting, 2, November 16th, 2015 executive session. Approve application by Witchmere Harbor Functions Limited Partnership for pledge of liquor license as required by lending institution. And D, approve petition by Verizon New England and Eversource Energy to relocate a pole on Harbor Way.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded to approve items A, C, and D on the consent agenda. Discussion? Hearing none, we'll put it to a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The vote. Thank you. Item E is the approved renewal of the 2016 mooring service agent permits as recommended by the Harbor Master. Michael, I think you had a question, or John's here, right? Yeah, there's John. Okay, John Rendon, yep. Why don't you come up to the podium, if you will.
Hey, John.
Hi.
Question is, what goes into this process? Is it a fair bid process? Do other people get to bid on this? Is it... And how does it differ from the other harbors besides the two we're approving tonight?
It is competitive bid. It's a three-year contract. Last year, it went out for bid. Our various areas where we have mooring servicing agents, and we ultimately take low bid unless there's something glaring that is a problem. Other towns do it a variety of different ways. Some have mooring servicing agents. Some don't require the use of a mooring servicing agent. Some have mooring servicing agents, a pool of mooring servicing agents that you can pick from. Vice, we have a mooring servicing agent assigned to a specific mooring field, and those people in that mooring field have to use that mooring servicing agent, or they can do it themselves under the direction of myself and the mooring servicing agent. So it just, it differs.
And are the fees consistent with all of our harbors, or
our mooring fees, or the mooring servicing agent fee?
Mooring.
I don't know. I haven't done that analysis.
And how do we advertise?
We put it out in the paper in the register.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, John.
Okay, you're welcome.
I'd like to make a motion on this.
Sure. I move we approve the renewal of the 2016 mooring servicing agent permits as recommended by Harbor Master.
Second.
Okay. Moved and seconded to approve the 2016 mooring service agent permits. Discussion? Hearing none, we'll put it to a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? It's a vote. Thank you. Okay, we'll move on to the public hearings versus the annual meeting with the library trustees. Mary, you were ill the other week. Hope you're feeling better.
Well, I very much appreciate being able to postpone, so thank you for that consideration. Good evening, Mary Ward, representing the Board of Trustees of the Brooks Library. This evening, other trustees who are with us are Bill Kroll, Kathleen Remillard, Joanne Brown, and of course, Jenny Hewitt accompanies us this evening. We'd like to remind anyone here or watching from home that the full annual report can be located on our website, brookslibrary.org, under Library Information, and then the section for trustees. We'd like to begin by saying thank you for your support to restore Monday hours. Thank you to the voters of Harwich for their support at town meeting, and thank you to you, our town administrator, the finance committee, and you, the Board of Selectmen, for your recognition of a community need for funding in the FY16 budget to make this possible. On September 14th, after a 10-year absence, The library reopened on Mondays, and the response from the community has been extremely positive. They're very appreciative. Reopening on Mondays has spread out the visits to the library, so it's easier to find parking space, and it's also resulted in increased use. Being open on Mondays is especially appreciated by parents of students who are now able to come every day after school, and by working people who have limited time to come to the library and appreciate an additional day when they're able to stop by on their way home from work. In February, it'll be 18 years since we moved back into the renovated and expanded building. We're happy to report that the volume of activity continues to grow as we successfully adapt to the changing needs and interests of the community. Currently, a few highlights. Currently, there are 13,231 Brooks Free Library cardholders, 9,555 of whom are full-time Harwich residents. Program attendance remains high. This past year, we provided 854 programs, which attracted 12,591 attendees. This past year, 237,000, almost 238 items were checked out, which represents a 54% increase in the past 10 years. And we responded to 16,840 reference questions, a 39% increase in the past 10 years. This year, we have continued outreach efforts related to technology. We are holding monthly technology assistant programs at the Council of Aging, Council on Aging, and Pine Oaks, recording tech talks on Channel 18, and continue to offer book librarian appointments for one-on-one technology help, in addition to weekly ebook help and device advice sessions and monthly technology workshops. We continue to collaborate with local teachers on projects related to curriculum and promote recreational reading by hosting field trips to the library and visiting classrooms. In collaboration with the librarian at Harwich Elementary School, we have several new initiatives. The Youth Services Librarian has just begun a new series of book talks in a different elementary school classroom every Friday morning, getting students excited about reading. And we've created a story walk at the middle school ball fields. The stories are changed frequently, and a number of elementary school teachers are taking advantage of the opportunity to allow students to stretch their legs and get some fresh air while focusing on reading. Currently, we are hosting a paid intern from the Massachusetts Commission for the Blind. Erin Mildy, a Brewster resident with sight loss, is working with Assisted Technology Coordinator Carla Burke, our vision impaired technology assistance at the library. This is our vital program. The executive director of the Massachusetts Commission for the Blind was so impressed by our instructional program that he recently visited to learn more about how we were able to successfully establish this innovative program. The commission is investigating potential funding sources they can use to have us assist them establish similar programs in other locations around the state. This fall, we're hosting an intern from Monomoy High School providing developmental work experience to a high school senior. We also participate in the senior tax work-off program and usually have several volunteers utilizing this program to reduce their property taxes. With respect to building projects and maintenance, this year, thanks to the efforts of two co-chairs of the Trustees Building and Grounds Committee, Jeannie Wheeler and Joanne Brown, and Town Facilities Manager Sean Libby, we accomplished a major project for the library, the installation of our new carpet. We are proud of the teamwork that enabled us to be open throughout most of the three-week project. The final result is beautiful. The old rippled and threadbare carpet is gone, replaced with carpet tiles in a beautiful teal color that matches the shelving and creates a much warmer and more welcoming environment. The carpet tiles should also improve maintenance and our ability to replace stained or worn areas as needed. We'd like also to extend a special thanks to maintenance worker Wes Langway, who Sean assigned to be on site at the library full time for the duration of the installation. It wasn't an easy logistical job, but Wes did it with a cheerful manner and a positive attitude, which helped set the tone and ease staff members' concerns as we got into the installation project. So we thank him for that. This year we completed an historic preservation assessment of the exterior, as you're aware, which was funded by the Community Preservation Committee. The consultants identified $800,000 in needed work on the exterior of the historic Brooks Block and original bank building. We organized a public presentation by the consultant, inviting all interested committees and departments, as well as the general public. On August 27th, the August 27th presentation ensured boards, committee members, and officials had an opportunity to hear the presentation firsthand. A question and answer period followed with great discussion on how to proceed. We've submitted the project for placement on the capital plan, as well as a request for CPC funding. As you know, we've been dealing with a number of electrical issues this year. Most recently, the library staff returned from Columbus Day weekend to find that the emergency light inverter had failed, and that the emergency lights and other lighting circuits that passed through the inverter were not working. It took 2 weeks for the manufacturer to repair the inverter. Although the library could not be open to the public for safety reasons, during that time, staff worked diligently to provide modified services, opening a, quote, library in the lobby during daylight hours where patrons could pick up items that had on hold. They were also able to select from a small collection of books and movies we set up in the lobby and check them out. We continued to provide reference services by phone and email, assisting patrons with technology questions, walking through the process of downloading ebooks and placing requests for items. We then arranged to move our programs to other locations so that our story times, book groups, writers groups, knitlet, and other activities could continue. We wish to express thanks to the Harwich Junior Theater for allowing us to use the HGT Art Center to run our after-school program the second week of closing. Parents were very appreciative of the additional effort we made to ensure their middle schoolers were safe and well supervised after school. Cape Destinations was very cooperative and quickly changed their drop-off location, and Monomoy Schools used their ConnectEd service to contact parents with the news of the closing and updates. We held story times that week at Chase Library, and thanks to the generosity of the Configuration Studio, who offered the use of their studio at the Harwichport Library. Thanks also to Carolyn Carey and her staff at the Community Center for generously providing rooms for various book groups, writers groups, library trustees, and so forth to meet. Thank you also to Ann Stidell and Sandy Robinson in the Town Administrator's Office for assisting us with using the library at Town Hall for several meetings, and the Griffin Room for a large program on aids and appliances for people with sight loss with the Mass Commission for the Blind on October 22nd. It was truly great to have such community support to help us continue to provide those services. We are very appreciative. I think we should be most proud that so many came together to support our community in this way. As trustees, we are particularly proud of the manner in which our director, Ginny Hewitt, and all of our library staff responded to this unexpected event. Throughout the long delay in waiting for the repair, they kept service to the community first in their minds. We would like to express our appreciation to facilities manager Sean Libby. He is extremely professional, aware of priorities and the impact of malfunctions and repairs on operations. We have already seen tremendous improvement in building maintenance since this position has been filled, but recognize that in order to fully address facilities issues townwide, more resources are needed. We understand that you recognize this need, and we would like to lend our support to the effort to fully staff a building maintenance department. The taxpayers will be better served by more responsive action on repairs to correct problems before they escalate, and by better preventive maintenance to avoid problems in the first place. We would also support consolidation of the building maintenance budgets from the various departments into one consolidated budget under the facilities manager beginning in FY17. Gratefully, we would like to recognize and thank the Friends of the Brooks Free Library who generously give of their time and effort to help us meet the needs of the community. We also benefit from the services of numerous volunteers. Last year, 130 individuals volunteered at the library, performing over 4,000 hours of volunteer service. The Chatham-Nauset Lions Club continues to be a great partner, supporting our vital program for people with vision loss. We'd also like to thank the Harwich Garden Club for the many hours of hard work maintaining a beautiful garden in our island of our parking lot. Without the help of these organizations and individuals, we would be unable to maintain the level of service we provide, so we greatly appreciate their efforts. In closing, Linda, thank you for your continued presence as our liaison from our board, or from your board to my board. Thank you very much for continuing as a liaison. And to Chris, we've very much appreciated your time and insight in meetings held regarding a variety of issues affecting the library during this past year. So with that, if there are any questions, we'd be happy to attempt to answer them.
I just made a couple comments. One is there, I just have a comment and question, I guess. One is that continues to amaze me that the numbers you have, how many people actually go through the library. I don't think the average citizen out there, you know, understands or even appreciates what a resource that is. Let's just put it that way.
Correct.
The numbers are quite frankly astounding, I think, when you look at it. I don't know how it compares with other towns and their populations and whatnot, but obviously we're doing something right over there. On the inverter aspect, it just what you reported sparks a question in my head, so to speak, spark. But I don't remember hearing Chris, or maybe from the trustees, whether or not the manufacturer of the equipment actually diagnosed what the problem or the source of the problem was. And we also talked about potentially getting the inverter repaired to use as a spare. And I'm just wondering where we are with all that.
Ginny would have some more information.
The last I spoke with Sean was before the Thanksgiving weekend. He had not heard back yet from the manufacturer about the circuit board. We did get, in the meantime, NSTAR has agreed to replace the transformer on the pole, even though they don't feel it's the problem. And there are other internal issues. It appears to be a mix of internal problems and fluctuating power. So we're working on that. We just spent about $3,000 on different electrical repairs, and we are still having issues with the dimming and flickering lights. So that remains a work in progress, but okay. Seems like we're getting there.
I just say seems we have an interest in knowing, you know, what the root cause of the problem was, if it can ever be figured out, and making sure, because of the time it took to get it repaired,
exactly,
that if that unit can be repaired so it's a spare sitting there, might be helpful. So thank you.
We would like that too.
Okay. Questions on the board or comments on the board? Anybody?
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you again. Yep. Okay, next we have a presentation, Town Engineer's Design of Lower County Road Project, Lincoln.
Hi. Mary checks in the mail. Thanks for those very favorable comments. You know, one brief moment. Mr. Libby, I was just speaking with him today about a couple of things, and I said, well, you're the new guy. He goes, new guy? Been here 2 years. Hired him 2 years ago. November. Time flies when you're having fun. The guy does amazing work. Before you this evening, for a couple of reasons. One, I'd like to gauge your support or palate to repair Lower County Road as a standalone project. And two, to get your feedback on utilizing the town engineer and surveyor to do the reconnaissance and the design of the project. Lower County Road, what we're talking about here, is the road in its entirety from Route 28 to the Dennistown line, approximately 2 miles. Yeah, about 2 miles long. We put a price tag of this of about $3.5 million. That price is very loose. It was derived by Lawrence Lynch, the company that did Route 137. It's a very similar size road, although the scope of 137 was much more, and plugging in data from Lower County Road to derive that number, which was in the neighborhood of what Chris had estimated anyhow. The road is in sections in deplorable condition. We have base problems. We have structural issues with it. We have some failing drainage, and we have a continuous sidewalk the entire length of the road, and not an ounce of it is ADA compliant. Anyone that's walked that sidewalk knows that every driveway and every roadway, they have a return, which is an old style, which leaves you about 2 feet of an actual ramp for a handicapped person to utilize. The entire roadway is done like that. you may be asking yourself, well, why can't we utilize, do this project with our existing county bids? Well, some of it we could bite off, some of it we couldn't. We feel that because the sidewalk is one of the major impetuses is being in front of you this evening and wanting this project in its entirety, we don't have any bids in place to address that. So we figure the best economies of scale would be to bid this project in its entirety and straighten out the sidewalk. This would be replacing the existing roadway where it is. We're not widening the roadway or proposing any other work. We do have to widen the sidewalk by 1 foot. We have a consistent 40-foot right-of-way on the road. That's a 4-foot sidewalk. It needs to be a 5-foot sidewalk to be ADA compliant. Another aspect is, you may, as many of you know, we get about $1.3, $1.4 million a year in support of our road maintenance program. I'm extremely proud of the work that Mr. Nickerson has done keeping Harwich's roads among what I consider the tops on Cape Cod, and probably go so far as to say the state. I think the roads are amazing condition. It's thanks to the support of this board, the Finance Committee, Capital Outlays, and this administrator and previous administrators. The roads are in great shape. I feel if we were to try to save our money to pay for a project of this scope and magnitude, that we would be 2 to 3 years of abandoning our road maintenance program, and it actually could end up costing us more in the long run, not getting to repair roads in decent condition before they need stuff like this done to them. Last aspect is the sidewalk. I had a conversation with town planner David Spitz, and he and I both agree that this sidewalk is probably the most utilized sidewalk we have in town. And again, not an ounce of it is ADA compliant. The second aspect of this is to have the survey and engineering done in-house. I have confidence that town engineer Bob Caffarelli and surveyor Paul Sweetser could do this job. Typically, these types of projects cost anywhere between 8% and 10% of the total project value in the form of engineering and survey. This is probably saving the town $200,000 to $300,000 doing it in-house. There is obviously lost opportunity cost in having it done in-house, but we would be more than willing to provide whatever labor Paul would need to go out and help him do the reconnaissance. And we've done smaller projects that Bob has engineered for us, so it's within their skill set.
So your intent would be to have the town engineer and surveyor design this, put together the bid package with you, and then get it out for bids? So, and when do you see that happening? What kind of time frame?
I put this on capital request for FY18, but you know, I'm saying FY18 and 19. If any of you have driven the road, we've got two sections that are very bad condition. We just threw, I don't know, 10, 15 grand at patching, $15,000 at patching, and Mr. Nickerson said, you know, where do you want me to stop? I could throw 50 at it and it would disappear like that.
But the point is, the town engineer and survey don't have to stop everything they're doing today and get on this project right away.
Yeah, just to answer that, we did have a meeting in-house just to make sure, and to answer that question, because obviously we don't want to have DPW stop and just focus on that. We don't want engineering to stop and focus on that. And in talking with Bob today, he kind of re-emphasized that what he would do is, this is a project that he can kind of fit in between others. As long as he has some flexibility, which Link said that, you know, he would give him some flexibility, he can get this work done. And it sounded like about 5 to 6 months worth of engineering, if I recall from our meeting, is what he was, you know, envisioning. So we won't be able to do a lot of other projects, but he will be able to sustain and keep going. The other thing that we did keep in mind is Bob is helping do the Muddy Creek project, and that Muddy Creek project will end at about the time that he would start this. So it does kind of line up in his schedule to try to get to. I think really the concern that we had was that if we're going to have Bob and Paul start down this road and do this work, if the ultimate project is going to be $3.5 million, and that's beyond Chapter 90 and beyond the town's means, you know, would this board be okay with the idea of putting something on the ballot for the next year asking for $3.5 million to do the project because we don't want to get down, I think, the road of, I know there was an allusion to 137, that was a transportation program, the TIP program. This is not a TIP program, and to give us flexibility to keep the road as aesthetically as it is now with the improvements to ADA, it's going to take the town funding that on its own.
Sure.
And not utilizing that TIP funding mechanism.
Yeah.
So before we went down that road, we wanted to make sure that the board was comfortable that this is a road that we want to travel.
Link is, could you just say sort of unequivocally, this is the worst road we have in town as far as a major thoroughfare goes? Or is it? I don't know.
I would make that statement. I'll defer to Mr. Nickerson.
It's in the top five.
It's in the top five. There you go. Okay. All right.
He's a technical guru.
Okay. Any questions from the board or council? Angelo.
Just curious, the extra foot of sidewalk, where does that come from?
Wherever it'll fit in.
The question I'm asking is, do we have an extra foot in the right-of-way?
We have a 40-foot right-of-way. What I believe we have out there now is 22 feet of pavement and 4 feet of sidewalk. So there's ample right-of-way to widen a sidewalk by 1 foot.
Do you plan on widening the road in the right-of-way itself?
No.
At all?
We have existing 11-foot lanes. We will end up with 11-foot lanes.
The reason I ask that question is during the summer, I'm so concerned about people riding their bicycles down there that somebody's going to really get hurt, because they go down there and people just tear down 28 and the road's just too narrow. You can't have two cars and one bicycle pass each other. It just doesn't work. The person on the side with the bike moves over. It's
this is Lower County, right?
Yeah, Lower County.
Yeah.
Yep. You just referenced Route 28.
Well,
I got confused.
I'm sorry.
Lower County.
We know what he meant. Coming. It's okay.
Just checking.
Right. Where it meets is even
town
worse.
Town planner may have a comment or a statement
comes
behind
down 28.
You.
When I bike on Lower County, which is actually quite a bit, I'd much rather be there than Route 28, and I wouldn't recommend it for a family of bikers. So you got to be careful. And I will say, when I go from here to Dennis on Lower County, I pass one or two bikes and 30 or 40 pedestrians. There is so much sidewalk use of Lower County with a population that comes in the summer on either side. You know, I was very glad to hear that Link is considering this project.
If I may, Mr. Chair, answer Selectman LaMancha's question. Absolutely, it's needed. It's a whole different scope of a project to provide bike lanes. I mean, all your drainage systems need to be replaced, and you're talking about, you wouldn't need to take right away, but what people consider their front lawns, now you're into a whole different scope of project, which I'd like to keep this into essentially a footprint program.
At that point, you're probably out of necessity going back to the state for some help just because of the magnitude of the project, I'm guessing.
Well, this road is TIP eligible. However, with the new complete streets that was adopted in 2012, I think you begin at 46 feet or 48 feet in total, and we have 40. So I didn't even broach that with the board.
Exactly. Okay. Anything else? So I think our sense here is that let's use the town engineer and town surveyor. Let's get this thing designed and see if we can take it forward. Okay.
Thank you.
All right, thanks. Okay, next we have a presentation on Sagatucket Harbor, Sagatucket Marine Dock Replacement Design Point Engineering. John, do you want to introduce this, or is Matt here? I don't know if he wants to introduce it. Take a minute, it's okay.
Hi, good evening. John Rendon, Harbor Master. This is Russell Titmus from Bourne Engineering, and really I'll pass it on to Russell here after a quick intro. We're here this evening just to kind of give you an update on where we are at with the design for the reconstruction of Sacotucket Harbor. We have been working towards a preferred alternative here, which Russell will speak to. And as a reminder, we're looking at replacing the docks, all the services that are associated with it, and also a big part of it is the dredging that needs to be done in order to get to our permitted depths. And so after he goes through his presentation here, we'll answer questions you know, to give you some additional information. So, Russell?
Okay. Good evening.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Can you speak into the mic?
Oh, yes. I beg your pardon, I'm sorry.
So
when we started this project, the intent was to build on the previous concept planning that work that had been done by another consultant. And we went into the layout, concept layout design of this marina with a few sort of criteria to follow. One was not to lose any slips, if possible to gain some additional slips. On top of that, the intent was to provide ADA compliant access to the ferry and the other passenger vessels that operate out of the harbor. And also to relocate that ADA compliant access so it was much closer into the bulkhead rather than where it is today, which is out in the middle of the harbor. It's the ferry ramp and everything is in this sort of general vicinity. So we started with the layout that had been prepared previously, and there were a few other criteria which we were sort of looking at, but really what we did is we reviewed design criteria for slip widths, slip lengths, and clearances for the different areas. And compared it as well to what the existing marina is, so we weren't going to make anything any worse than it is today. The goal is to maintain that as a minimum standard, but also to look at what current standards would be. So we used a few different standards that are out there. There's a California standard for marina layout. There's one from the American Society of Civil Engineers, and there's a few other documents as well.
Using which I assume basically has to do with how much space you need for a certain size boat.
Right.
I'm guessing. Okay.
That's the short answer. The marina right now, today, is really split into three different classes.
Yes, 20 foot, 30 foot, and 40 foot.
So the intent was to maintain those same classes and not to distort the balance between the spaces that are available today. So this was the layout we actually came up with in the end. Building on what was out there. What we managed to do was increase the number of slips slightly. We've gone from, it's, correct me because I know you fixed the numbers today, it's 191.
We have 191 currently, and this proposal gets us to 202.
So we managed to add about 10 slips in here. The access to the marina has a new gangway access at this end to provide the ADA compliant access. This would be a 42 foot long gangway, much longer than the ones that are out there today. The ones out there today are only about 20 feet long. ADA requires a maximum slope of 1:12. Mm-hmm. There's also the Mass Architectural Access Board, which has slightly different requirements. They're subtly different. And this 42 foot gangway would actually comply with both sets of requirements and also provide us with some latitude for sea level rise in the future. So as sea levels rise as we go forward, the 42 feet provides some extra flexibility in that. So we're building a little resiliency into this. We've maintained the existing access points into the marina. There's actually two other access points which come out onto the marina, and we've maintained those. There's a few other things we looked at with this, which we're still sort of developing, working with John. One is materials for these areas. Our recommendation was for the main access sort of floats into through the marina to use concrete to provide extra stability. So it's concrete which has got styrofoam cast inside it, provides a much more stable platform. The other areas could be either timber construction, so similar to what's out there today, timber with flotation underneath it, or else you can use composite type decks. There's some higher grade timber as well. You can use like tropical hardwood. So they all impact the costs and things. One of the things we've actually ended up doing with this also is encroached a little further. So we've managed to pick up the 10 extra slips because we've expanded slightly further out into the open harbor water. What we have looked to maintain, there's a federal channel that comes in maintained by the Army Corps. And the channel that comes in is a 75-foot width, but they also have this mooring area, turning basin on the end. So we've tried to maintain the minimum 75 clearance all the way through as far as we can towards the boat ramp. What we've also been able to maintain is a large turning area in front of the boat ramp near the fuel dock and where the larger, where the ferry would be. In terms of design of this, we are fairly early on in this, but we're proposing that the piles and things would be similar to what you see out there today, so it would be timber piles and everything. There's a dredging element proposed for this project as well. Most of the boats that are out there only require a draft of 6 feet or less, which is what the original harbor dredging was when it was originally constructed. There's an area, again, in this area where the larger passenger boats would be, where we propose to go slightly deeper to 8 feet. As part of that effort, in terms of looking at the dredge depths, we also looked at the condition of the bulkhead. There's a bulkhead all the way down this shoreline and the bulkhead behind the fuel dock and the loading area for the fishing vessels. The bulkhead along the main shoreline through here is actually supported by angled timber piles that work like a prop in front of the wall. And the condition of some of the connections between those piles and the bulkhead is getting a little shaky, so we're recommending also doing some minimal repairs to the bulkhead. This isn't a bulkhead replacement project, it's just minimal repairs to make sure we're comfortable with when we do the dredging. In terms of dredging requirements, although the entire footprint was originally designed based around a 6 foot minimum depth, there's probably a little bit of tuning we can do in terms of the actual depths we end up going forward with. And the primary reason for that would be cost, and you'll see when we get into the slide I've got for costs. Dredging is one of the very major costs in this as a project. And the problem with the dredging is it's a pretty wide band at the moment. Until we confirm the nature of the material to be dredged and where it can be disposed of, the cost per cubic yard can vary pretty dramatically by a factor of two at least. So it can be pretty dramatic. So what we're looking at right now is assuming that all of this area in here gets dredged to 8 feet and the remainder gets dredged to 6 foot depth. But in order to control those costs, it may be necessary just to sort of look at maybe not going quite so deep where some of the smaller boats are moored. Anything I missed in that?
Just to real quickly go through what this slide looks at. The yellow are the 20-foot slips. The red are 30-foot slips. The blue are the 40-foot slips. And I will be coming before the board to propose that we establish a 50-foot category. We have several big boats in our harbor. There's a need for it. Everybody wants a bigger boat. We have kind of an internal list to try to, you know, for the several big spaces that we currently have, we have an internal list for that. So I really think we should establish a 50 to 65. 65 is the cap in our harbor. And so what you see here is we've been able to provide up to 7 slips for those larger boats, and of course that's additional income. So what you see here, if I can, yeah, right there, if you could point to where we're going to put the commercial guys,
right,
that area right there, that would be our commercial fleet. They're all 40, well, they're not all, but majority are 40 foot. We have 9 40 foot
is that 9, 1, 2, 3, yeah, I think 9, 40-foot commercial folks. So I think it's an ideal location for them. Obviously, they offload at the bulkhead there, and then they can just go short distance to where they would tie up there, keep them all together. And then right, the red area, the 30-foot slips right behind that, and we would look to put our charter fleet there, so.
The only thing to add about compliance with ADA as well is that when you have a marina with, I want to say it's anywhere between 150 and 300 slips, there's a requirement to provide 5 slips at least within the marina that meet ADA requirements for accessibility, which means that the new gangway and everything that provides access through here can feed on into the marina and provide that ADA compliant access to some of the slips. So that's the reason for the 40-foot boat in tight here. That would actually be one of the designated slips that would be ADA compliant. Yep. So this was just a summary existing layout versus the proposed and the number of slips. So although they weren't split out in the existing layout, the passenger vessels, we've actually got the 4 designated slips on top of the numbers we've got listed in there for the different sizes. These are just the proposed design criteria, so you've got a comparison. I guess the key part of this is just proposed to existing. There's a fairly wide spread in some areas in the marina today on what the double slip width that is. These are clear widths. So that's the clear distance between the mooring fingers within the marina. So what we're proposing to go with are the numbers down the, if this works, down here. So we've tried to strike a middle ground. We're not trying to reduce anything from where it is today. And again, it's based on what's out there as design guidance today, current design standards. This was just where we're at as well in terms of the, this factors more into the pile design and so the costing for the marina in terms of proposed design criteria for the operating conditions really in the marina. Under the new FEMA mapping, the whole of Saquatucket Harbor is a V-zone, which means it has higher wave action. It's somewhat surprising to me, given its sheltered nature. It's very, very sheltered in there, but it is all mapped as V-zone. So with that in mind, the FEMA 100-year or 1% annual chance storm condition is really representative of a hurricane-type condition coming through. So the designation for a V-zone means you have waves at about 3 foot in height or greater. So we've just assumed that we're going to get 3 foot wave height under the 100-year storm condition and hurricane type wind speeds. But to survive that kind of condition, it means the vessels can't be there. Not with the pile design we're proposing at the moment, which is using timber piles, which are comparable to what is used today. If you tried to design it for with vessels in place, you've obviously got much more wind area, more side area on the hulls and everything for waves. And so you'd need to go to more piles or stronger piles. And then we have a couple of other design criteria we normally look at, a survival type condition. This is for 50 mile an hour winds and a 1.5 foot wave, all the vessels in place. And then working stress design, which is a slightly lower standard again. But it's pretty common in the kind of work we do with engineering in these conditions where you try and make sure you've got a design upper limit. You don't necessarily try and make everything work at working stress for that. So the cost, this is the crunch slide really. The total cost down here, we've got about $7.2 million. That does include close to $1 million of contingency right now. It's based on 15% contingency. That's just to reflect the very limited state of the design today. There's two key numbers I wanted to flag in here as well, the dredging. Right now we're assuming 12,500 cubic yards. And we're presuming a mid-range cost for that of about $100 a cubic yard.
We think this is a reasonable budget to go forward with, because we think we can either hopefully get a lower cost for the actual dredging. When Allen's Harbor was done recently, it was about $65 a cubic yard. That material was taken offshore and disposed of in open water. It tends to be one of the lower cost methods. The only thing that's cheaper than that is if everything turns out to be sand and it can go on the beach. If you have to go upland and you're paying tipping fees to a landfill or something, then it can easily be $150 a cubic yard for dredging. The utilities number down here, we're assuming right now that each slip gets electricity, water, and wireless. There would be fire protection out in the marina as well. And we will be maintaining the bubbler system that's out there, so that will get replaced. So this number is very preliminary right now, the 500,000. I would expect as we go forward with design, that number will go up and the contingency number will go down. So it'll be a trade-off within the total numbers. This is just an indication of where dredging would be needed to get the 6 foot and 8 foot depths today. So you can see it's all fairly close into the bulkhead. So if we were looking to try and reduce the cost of the dredging work, reduce the volume of the dredging work, these would be areas where we could try and reduce that requirement. So we could go to maybe a 4 foot or a 5 foot depth and reduce the volume that way. Apologies, I'm not sure why the slide's quite so fuzzy with this. This was just to try and indicate the ADA area in better detail. A 42-foot long gangway, which would actually be built back into the shoreline, so right next to the existing boat ramp, we would create a notch in the ground there that the gangway could sit inside, and then it would connect onto the main floating system. This would all be at a raised freeboard by building an aluminum platform on top of the concrete float, so it would match exactly into the ferry freeboard, which is about 4 foot six. So you'd walk down the moving gangway, you'd be on a level platform which is going up and down with the float, but it's at a freeboard of 4 foot six, so you can just walk right onto the stern of the ferry. As you come down through this system, the Yankee, which has got a similar freeboard to the ferry, I believe we actually need to extend this float to match into, but you would access the Yankee by coming along this float, same similar freeboard, then there's a ramp system that takes you down successively to the lower freeboard passenger vessels, and then ultimately out onto the concrete floats into the gangway. I'm not sure that we necessarily need to dwell on these. These were slides really just in case anyone had questions about how this compared to the existing layout.
That's existing. That's today. Yeah.
So where are you with the design? What phase are you in these days? When do you think you'll finish the design?
Well, we've got a concept design. So what we're looking to try and get as a blessing for, you know, the kind of concept we've got here is in terms of going forward with the project. It doesn't need a lot more development before we can get into permitting. For permitting, for the environmental permits for this kind of project, you're probably looking at about a 6 month timeline for the permitting at least. The dredging is probably the thing that will drag things out the longest. That's the thing that they tend to look closest at.
When do you have enough design documentation so that you can go out for bid on the project?
The intent would be you go forward with permits now, you'd look to get unofficial blessing for the design and the permitting about 3 or 4 months out, and then you can do the final design so that by the time you get the final permits, you're in a position to go to bid. So we'd be looking at going to bid sometime around June or July next year.
Okay, which is after town meeting. Yeah, okay. All right, and I'll just make out, my observation is, having been down there, that safety is a bigger issue than anything else down there, and a reason to do this. I mean, I'm not a boater, so how much you've got for depth and whatnot isn't a big factor to me. But just walking on the docks, the instability as you walk on the docks and whatnot, and this is not after you know, a late night cocktail or anything. It's just walking during the day and doing it with kids and whatnot. It's very unstable, as we've had that discussion before.
Right.
So that's the main reason for getting this done, you know, along with there are some other benefits, obviously. I would ask, though, that when, assuming this construction goes forward, how would it disrupt the boating season, if you will, the folks that are there already, and how do you see that being handled?
Yeah, I mean, we're going to try to do it in one phase. We've had discussions whether we should try to do it in two phases or not. I think then your costs really go up when you try to do it in two phases, because you got mobilization, demobilization, prep, all that is doubled. And so, you know, I sent out a letter to all our permit holders, giving them a heads up that if we're successful at town meeting, that their boating season may be short by a couple of weeks. But on you know, come end of October, we'd want everybody out so that we can get in there and start dredging, because we have a dredge limit to January 15th, I believe, is our winter flounder issue that we have to deal with. So we have to get our dredging done right away. So it would have a small impact on our permit holders, but we're hoping that a lot of the docks can be built off-site, and once we get dredged, they bring them in already constructed and put in place. So
your expectation is you'd start sometime at the end of the boating season, roughly.
That's right.
And then you'd be back in business before the new season starts the following year.
That's the hope.
Okay.
Right.
All right, good. And we will have you in the Waterways Committee as well at some point to talk about how we might pay for this, and, you know, some of those concepts as we go forward, probably in January. Would be my expectation. I know it's a topic the board is interested in, so I think everybody else is too. So
okay.
With that, any questions from the board or comments from the board?
No, I think it's a great plan.
When you say you need a blessing, you're looking for a blessing from us, or are you looking for the Waterways Committee to say go, or are you looking for the
Harbor
Master to
say go? Well,
we did
present this plan to the Waterways and got some very good feedback from the committee, and I just want to make sure that you know the direction we're going, and put it out there, because obviously, you know, we're going to be looking at who can construct the concrete floats, and, you know, what the pricings are, and of course the permit. So I don't want to get down the road and then all of a sudden, you know, have to do a U-turn because you weren't aware of it. So that's
a very expensive project, no doubt, you know, in the scheme of things, no doubt
it
about
is.
It, but it's needed. So Linda,
how solid is that $7.2 million that's there? Is
putting you on the spot there,
right?
You know, just as it, you know, in your professional, your opinion of the two of you, you know, is this going to go to 10 million or is it 7.4 million? Is that 7.2 sort of a
6 million?
A sort of a good, yeah, 6 million would be better, but is that sort of a reasonable amount?
I think it's a reasonable amount at this stage. Like I said, there's the one that bothers me most is the dredging. Because until you go and get the samples and until you get the chemical testing done, you don't know where it can go.
Yeah.
And so I think the dredging, like I said, the low ball end of the dredging could be 800,000 maybe. The top end of dredging, if we dredge the entire volume that we were showing in there, could easily be, you know, 1.6 million or something by itself. So that's the variation. I think we'd look to try and reduce the 1.6 if we had to, by limiting the volume. So if we had to dial down what we'd hope to dredge to reduce the cost, then we could probably adjust it that way as well.
But, you know, I'm guessing on the dredging, you dredge now to the depth you want, you pay the money now, as opposed to having to do additional maintenance later or something. I don't know. I mean, if you dredge down to 6 feet, I don't know how long it takes before it's going to get up to 4 feet, and you got to dredge again. I mean, obviously with harbors, dredging is almost a constant thing. But if you look at, I'll just call it life cycle, in what the dredging budget would be over a 20 or 30 year period of time, it'd be interesting to know. You know, does it make more sense, quite frankly, to dredge the darn thing now to 6 feet and be done with it? You know, so
it almost certainly does. Rather than get into a cycle of trying to do it every 5 years, because to get in there and dredge, once
right.
you've got all the floats in, you've got the added cost of dismantling part of the float system at least.
Right.
You may
Is there any play for the county dredge in this?
Again, I think it has to do with what the material is, and,
okay.
and we'll look at that option. Absolutely.
And maybe there's a section they can do or something, or
yeah, similar to what we did over in Allen Harbor. Yeah, remember, we did a section there and we built a berm and
right.
Yeah. So I see Link left.
I know. Just
a scared. I think.
Chris, did you have a comment?
Yeah, I just wanted to make a comment. Or I guess a comment and a question. First, I'm born to do the work on the Witchmere dock. And the one thing I like to see is that they had an estimate and it came in slightly below estimate. So that gives me some credibility that they knew what they were doing in terms of estimates. And that's critical in terms of budgeting. The second is, obviously, the board's going to be confronted with having to put a question on the ballot and have something ready for town meeting. Will the numbers be at a point where the estimate is fairly solid coming up in the middle of April, so that way when town meeting is presented that we have a better sense for the type materials, when the you know, how much the dredge will cost and so on?
Yeah, the next step that we have to go through is to request a sampling and testing plan from the Army Corps. We have to get their blessing for how we're going to sample and test the material. We'd anticipate getting out there to do the sampling and testing sometime early January, as soon as we can, essentially. We'll know what the material is then, so we'll know much better what the options are. If it's all coming back sand, then the answer becomes very straightforward and it can all go on a beach. I don't expect that to be the answer, because we did go out and we took some hand samples where we could reach. It's close into the bulkhead, and the area there is much siltier. It's the sort of material that is either going offshore or going for off-site disposal.
And I do know on the Witchmere project that we had some discussion, and changing some materials was able to decrease the cost or increase the cost. So I know that there's some, I don't want to say flexibility, but some decisions that can be made that would, right, you know, not affect the life cycle cost too much, but give us a more cost-effective project.
Right. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you for the update, and we look forward to more information as we go forward. Obviously, you know, we'd like to be in a position where we have bids before we get to town meeting, but we understand, you know, we're going to have to watch that process. So, okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Give you a second to power down. All set. Okay, next, Jim, you here? No, Jim Chevry. Okay, Jim asked that to come in and make a presentation on the Judy Aldridge property. Anybody remembers this is the property that is in East Harwich that was on the town meeting warrant last year. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good.
Jim Chevry from East Harwich. Last spring, during the No on Nine campaign, I had an opportunity to speak to a lot of Harwich residents about the Six Ponds DCPC, and specifically the 25-acre parcel of land known as the Judah Eldridge parcel along Hawks Nest Road. A common theme began to emerge. People really wanted this land to be preserved. One person after another urged me to look past the No on Nine campaign, and if we were successful in defeating Question 9, they wanted me to work with the town to try to get this land into conservation use so future generations could enjoy this jewel that Harwich has. To this day, I continue to get emails and Facebook messages from people asking where I am on this. A couple of weeks ago, I've attended a lot of meetings, Planning Board, Wastewater Implementation Committee meetings, Selectmen meetings. I've seen you at all at many of these meetings. And I attended a Planning Board meeting where the board discussed the proposed zoning changes for East Harwich. And they voted to submit this plan to the Selectmen. During this discussion, they opened up the meeting to public comment. There were several residents who spoke about the need and their desire to see land set aside to be used as offsets against future growth. There were at least two people who I don't know by name and who were not involved in the No on Nine campaign, who specifically brought up the Hawk's Nest parcel and suggested that this land should be looked at to be used as such an offset. They spoke about how the land is owner's unknown, no property tax has been paid on it, and since it is in the Six Ponds DCPC, it would be a perfect fit for both preservation and a buffer of sorts between the denser commercial zone and the residential areas of the DCPC. A couple of weeks ago, on November 16th, at the Selectmen's meeting, the Planning Board made their presentation to a standing room only crowd. And during public comments, once again, several people spoke about the need for offsets. and it seems apparent that any talk of changing zoning and increasing density needs to be tied into a discussion involving offsets. And I think between the sewer discussions and the new East Harwich zoning discussions that are occurring, acquiring this parcel would dovetail nicely into both of these plans. And I think the time is right to start thinking about the possibility of having the town acquire this parcel for conservation use, thereby removing it from inventory for future development. And I know from individual discussions I've had with several of you that you, at least in theory, support this idea. The land is owner's unknown, and as such, has not had property tax paid on it. So removing it from buildable inventory would not short the town any of this tax money. Ballot question number 9 had the price tag for these 25 acres as being around $400,000. And given the large price tag of that the wastewater plan is carrying, this is indeed a bargain, and one I'm sure the voters would approve of. We have an opportunity before us to acquire a very large parcel of land for conservation. And judging by the way the voters spoke at the spring election, there is overwhelming support to preserve this area. And I would like to suggest that adding offsets to these discussions and acquiring a parcel as large as this one would go a long way towards the eventual success of the sewering and zoning change projects. So I come before you tonight to at least start a discussion on this and get a general sense of what the board thinks, and to see if you would at least in theory support such an idea. And I would be more than willing to assist in this project, and I'm open to any input or direction you might have. And obviously my hope would be to have this be a cooperative effort between the voters who are driving this and the selectmen. Thanks. I don't really know where we go from here other than me presenting this to you folks.
Okay, well, I'll just start. Appreciate you bringing it forward. And you know, I know there's a lot of interest in it. The natural place, I think, where it starts in the process is to go to Real Estate and Open Space Committee, because in almost all cases, we look to them to at least evaluate the property and decide, do they want to bring it forward to us as an opportunity to put it into conservation or whatever. Then there's the whole process. You know, we have this thing started out as a land bank, and now it's CPC funding or whatever, where we have money set aside every year for open space, if you will. And to me, that's one funding source that, you know, they should be tapped and should be utilized for this. So unfortunately with CPC, they just, I think a month or so ago,
October 1st,
closed their process for the year as far as getting, you know, submissions in, if you will. But I think it's just my suggestion, if you go to the Real Estate and Open Space Committee and get them educated on it, get them to come back and say, yeah, this is something we want to do. Because my sense is, you're right, I think my sense is that the board would like to do that as well. And then, you know, have them endorse that concept and then see if it can't get, you know, Land Bank or CBC funded for the following year. So that's where I see it at the moment. I don't know of anybody out there ready to pounce on this property. Maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think so. So I think we do have some time to, you know, think this through a little bit.
Yeah, and the reason I brought it up is because of all the meetings that we've been having, I kind of think that this almost fits into the plan in some way. I don't know which way.
Well, but I think regardless, even if we weren't talking about zoning in East Harwich, which, by the way, my personal opinion is it's not going anywhere for this town meeting just because the sides are so far apart on the topic. That's just my feeling at the moment. I think this is an important parcel, and it should be, you know, brought in under, you know, conservation or, you know, as open space or whatever you want to call it. And I think it's important to do that. So, you know, we got to work towards doing that.
Great.
Regardless of whether somebody needs an offset in East Harwich or not. I mean, if it ends up being a bonus, great. But if not, we have it anyhow, right?
Right.
It could very well be that in East Harwich, the zoning just stays the way it is because people can't agree and, you know, it goes the way it goes. I just don't know.
Right.
I just don't know. Janelle?
Okay.
Yeah.
Any comment?
So, because its owner's unknown, and there are so many back taxes, the town would take it by eminent domain?
Don't know. I mean, that's part of a discussion.
Otherwise, how would we even begin to put it into conservation if we don't own it, technically?
You have to own it, absolutely.
Which is the only way we can own it is by eminent domain?
Sort of.
Okay. So.
I guess there are ways in which we could take land. In this case, where there's owners unknown, the cleanest way to acquire title and acquire access to the land is to do by eminent domain. So when we had this, obviously we went through with the attorney last year what the process would be. I think one thing, just to make sure everyone's aware, is even though the back taxes are owed on it, that we would have to basically raise and appropriate the money, fund the $400,000 or whatever the appraisal was, and put that into a, lack of a better term, escrow account. We would be the first ones that would draw off that escrow account because we have back taxes owed to us. So that's where the net is. We would be paying for the land, but also paying ourselves. But we do have to raise that money and come up with that money and put it in the escrow before that. And what Owners Unknown does, or what the eminent domain does, is that gives us access to the land instantly. In terms of if any of the owners do surface that want to have money, they would be able to draw off that escrow account. So there is some mechanics that have to go into it, but I think if the town established that it was a valid public need for open space, that certainly that would be one avenue. And where the Owners Unknown issue is substantial, then I think eminent domain is the right approach to take for the acquisition of the property.
And is eminent domain a town meeting subject?
Oh, absolutely.
So yes. we're waiting at least until May before we can do anything.
More than
well, I think, yeah, there's a couple issues in my mind that obviously you could do a citizen petition and go forward without a potentially a funding source. Or you could, voluntarily work with the selectmen. The selectmen put anything on, obviously, on the warrant. So if the board wanted it on and said, could we go for the FY17 annual town meeting and have a funding source identified in CPC funds, then obviously that would be more cooperative, which I think is what I'm hearing. So, I mean, there's really two avenues to go down. One is kind of doing citizen petition. Obviously, that's open to anybody, and we have that process on the website, or work with the board to see if we can identify the funding source going forward.
And with citizen petition, where would the funding source come from? Also from CPC, or is that citizens?
It would not
citizens
be able
would
to,
raise the funds.
I'm sorry. It would not be able to come from CPC because the cycle is already well underway, so there's not an opportunity to have that funding source in there for this year. Unless revenue could be identified or free cash could be identified, most likely it would be a debt exclusion, which is the process that we used last year when the recommendation went to the electorate.
You know, whatever pot it comes out of, it's still all taxpayer money.
It's still,
I know how you look at it. So, Linda, do you have a question or comment?
I think just you can apply to, let's just be clear, you can apply to CPC with applications, and the committee will decide what they would like to bring forward for funding. I think I'm hearing some comments here that would be a no-brainer, but it has to go through the committee.
I understand.
I do think that it would be a good idea for you to go through the Real Estate and Open Space Committee. That's my opinion, because this board has not voted support, Peter, for one way or the other.
Right.
We haven't had that discussion. So just to make that clear, too, and I'm not saying I would vote against it. I'm just saying that there has been no formal vote for the board to say we would support this.
Well, there's also a process, you know.
And there is a process, which is going to the Real Estate Open Space, the appraisal process, all of that, we have that established. And so that would probably be the place to start.
Else? Michael?
I just wanted to thank Jim for his continued work on this and efforts. And I would certainly support it.
Thanks. I am leaning towards a petition article at town meeting. I have pulled the paperwork for that. And we're discussing that, but I don't think that's not a cooperative effort that I would rather have, which is why I came to you folks to try to see if, obviously there's a lot of talk in town and there's a lot of desire to see that area up there kind of stay the way it is. So a better way of doing this would be a cooperative effort. But that cooperative effort could also be the selectmen bringing forward a article for town meeting that really would mimic Article 27. The way I see it, and I'm not a lawyer, but that exact article could be written the way it was, strike out seven words, wastewater treatment plant and or effluent recharge zone, and insert the words conservation use, and be done with it. And I really believe that with my help, I can really get this out to the voters, and I can almost guarantee that the voters would vote for this just based on what I heard from talking to people. So that's another option that you know, I was hoping that maybe you could consider, and I don't know what the process would be in that either. But I think that that would almost, you know, there was some bad blood last April that occurred, and I almost think this might be, and then, you know, there's a lot of discussions occurring now with the zoning and with the sewering, and I almost see, if this came from you folks, I almost see this as being almost like an olive branch to the voters, maybe not in those terms, but it would be almost a gesture of goodwill, for lack of a better word, and I could certainly help with that. Anyways, I just want to leave you with that thought and have you kind of kick that around.
Yeah, no, that's fine. And I would just say this, that you know, we have the Real Estate and Open Space Committee in place for a purpose.
Okay.
I think you can get on their agenda pretty quickly. I mean, you know, whenever the next meeting is, I don't know when that is.
Okay.
But, you know, they meet every month, certainly. And present it to them, just like you presented it to us. I'm sure they're familiar from last year with the project. And all I'm asking or suggesting is that then they bring it forward to us and say, yes, we think it's a project we should take forward. And, you know, maybe in their discussions, they could say, we think it's important to take it forward now, as opposed to waiting for the next, you know, land bank or CPC cycle. That's all.
Yep.
So I would just say, thanks, as a courtesy, that would be a good thing to do. In my mind, you know, it doesn't cost anything to do that.
Sure.
It takes a little bit of time, but you've got to go to, you know, one more meeting and, you know, make a presentation with them. No, I know. I understand.
Just joking.
But then it makes them feel like they're part of the process, which is not a bad thing. Let me just say that. Okay.
It isn't. You're right.
Can I say what it is?
I'm the liaison to Real Estate and Open Space at this point, so I'd be happy to help introduce you to Kathy, who is the chair, and see if we can get you on an agenda.
It's the third Friday at 8:30.
So
up.
We can do that,
okay,
in the next
couple days.
Okay.
So before Christmas. You could at least get before them. Now, whether they make a decision or not, I don't know. But at
right.
least it gives them the courtesy of...
I think a lot of the other work has been done as well.
Yeah.
The appraisal's
sure.
been done.
Might have to update the appraisal. It's now a year and a half old. So, you know, maybe a quick update to the appraisal, which would be short dollars. And
the only problem I see is if we go forward that way, it's going to have to be a debt exclusion.
Yeah.
And that always gets to be...
It's a ballot.
This is what it is.
It's
people
a ballot.
Get the vote.
It's a ballot, and it gets to be tacky. If is there a way that he can chat with the CPC folk to get a feeling of how they would vote, even if it's next year?
Well, of course, he can always talk to the chair and talk with the CPC, who is meeting on Thursday night, I believe.
Yeah, it's this Thursday.
Thursday at like 6:30 or 7, the CPC will vote, so... And they'll be here.
Yeah, but they're voting on requests that have already been submitted.
They may or may not be voting. I think they're in discussion, but I think as they asking if we can make that kind of comment and asking them to consider that.
Again, in the spirit of, you know, bringing people together and trying to do some cooperation,
right.
I just think it's worthwhile to make contact with these people and see what you get for an answer.
Right.
See, even if they say that it's looks like a great project, but we can't actually fund it until next year. You know, we could vote on that with...
It's a data point.
You know.
But I don't think that they can't commit.
I understand
another
that.
Committee
I understand
to
that.
It.
They
can't.
Thank you.
Keep going.
All right.
Thanks,
thank
you. Peter. Yep, thank you. Okay, moving on. We don't have any old business unless you get something to bring up. New business, the wastewater moment. You notice on here there's nothing about votes or anything else. So the intent here is just to bring up to this board, I think the sooner we figure out what we want to take to the 2016 annual town meeting, the better off we're all going to be.
Yep.
And, you know, I would recommend as a minimum, if we can, to get the Chatham agreement, intermunicipal agreement, if you will, ironed out. And it could actually stop at that point. You know, I think that this whole discussion about governance and whatnot, in my mind, doesn't have to get sorted out this year because we're not ready to put a shovel in the ground. The whole topic of you know, infrastructure charges and that kind of thing can be delayed if we want to. The design work with East Harwich, because zoning's not done yet, still some stuff going around that I don't think will get resolved, you know, in time for town meeting. Certainly, you know, we can push that out a year. You know, I think with Muddy Creek and some other things we're doing, we're making enough progress to show that we're not, you know, we're not neglecting this topic. So I just like to lay these things out and say, hey, we ought to set a time when, you know, particularly you folks on the, you know, on the negotiating team for Chatham are ready to have a discussion about it. We should do that. Angela.
I think that the two of us, and right over there is another gentleman who was at a meeting a couple of weeks ago with
when you say right over there, what do you mean? Oh, Jim, okay.
Jim, who was very helpful, as a matter of fact, at that other meeting. Prior to that meeting, I would have been in the same kind of position, sort of feeling that you were at. After that meeting, there were, I think, a lot of positive direction that appeared, and I think we do need to take a look at how we put that together, and it may well be that it is time to go forward. I'm not saying that it is, but I think we need to take a look at it, because a lot of things came out at that meeting of things that we could do to make things even more positive and go forward.
So what I would say is when you...
We have to get... We owe you a piece of paper.
Get your ducks lined up and whatnot, and get your, you know, the things ready. Bring it back to us sooner rather than later, and let's have a discussion about how we want to proceed.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
have
just
we
on
heard
the,
anything back from...
Yeah, that? Just on the status of the negotiations, I meet with Bob Duncanson. Obviously, I see him as part of Muddy Creek. And what he's asked or offered is that I think they basically agreed in concept with the, when we had the meeting with them, the concepts that we had laid out, he's actually having that drafted in an IMA form. Originally there was a concepts, if we agreed to the concepts, then committed to an IMA. We have an agreement on the concepts, I think, so he's gonna commit it to an IMA. And I know his timeline to get that working draft back to us was middle of December. So I'm hoping to have that material back to the subcommittee, you know, with the holidays and stuff, either just before the holidays or just after the holidays, I would guess.
And I think we could probably get the regulation piece by then also, don't you?
Have you had any weigh-in from Bob on the regulation piece? I know some comments were sent back by David Young. Paula Champagne sent some back. Linda had some. Have you approached?
Yeah, no, we haven't. We haven't spoken specifically in terms of that.
And have they come back to us with any numbers yet?
No.
Are they going to put that in the?
They're going to put that in the IMA.
Okay.
The other thing to keep in mind is we still don't have what I would call an approved plan yet.
Right.
You know, I keep hearing the date kind of roaming around. So.
I think with that said, you know, there's been a lot of talk about recharge site, and there's been a lot of talk about zoning. One thing that we may want to address is the plan has a pretty major zoning change. Do we want to base that plan on current zoning and take away that major build that people can think to do away with the fear that people have that we're going to put Hyannis in East Harwich?
Part of the discussion.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think we need to. That's why I think we need to get that section written, because that was, I think, a very positive direction at that other meeting.
Okay. Again, my feeling is just my feeling based on what I hear and the feedback I get is that the any changes in zoning in East Harwich are not going to happen for this town meeting. I just think.
Right. My point is, I don't think it needs to be in the plan.
Right. Exactly.
Going forward.
Anything else on that? The sooner we can get this back to us, the better, but I want to be able to get to a point where we can say, okay, these are the one or two or five things we're going to try and take to town meeting and get accomplished.
And to that end, I think that getting it mid-December would be better than getting it mid-January, because if we get it mid-December and we can send back questions, that's only going to help us on an article for town meeting. If we wait till mid-January, then by the time we get stuff done, we're going to be scrambling to get it into a warrant, do publicity, educate people, and we're going to end up just running out of time, and the thing will get IP'd because nobody will understand
it. So all we want for Christmas is...
All I want for Christmas in the middle of December is, yeah, along with my two front teeth, is
okay.
IMA.
All right. Anything else on that topic?
Nope.
Okay. Town Administrator's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We did have a meeting, I think it was last week or the week before, in which the Muddy Creek construction schedule. That's still kind of a work in process, but we have that fairly close. So hopefully at the next meeting I'll have that and we can put it up so people can look. Just a couple things that have come up out of the Muddy Creek. We had a phone call today with Fish and Wildlife. They were thinking about doing a kind of a kickoff meeting. They've changed that to do a media release. So they do want to have an acknowledgement. Most of the funds for this project are coming from outside sources. So we were going to have an acknowledgement of that. Two major grants, Fish and Wildlife Grant and a Hurricane Sandy grant, are the two primary funding. And we are on a fairly short list to get a one from NOAA. I think it's a $300,000 grant. We have not officially heard from that, but we do anticipate hearing from that. That will make that project, that $300,000, hopefully will be kind of the final piece to give us a little bit of margin of error. As you mentioned, as I mentioned when we did the contract award with the MAS people, that was a very, very tight project. So having that grant will be a benefit. So hoping to hear back on that. This week, that road is going to be closed and detours will be in effect. That's because of some of the temporary utility work. They had to install a bridge. So the road will be closed from 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. That's kind of what they've been approved to do, to work in. So that will follow, I believe, for the duration of this week. The major part of the project won't start until January 4th. We did have a discussion too with the folks from Fish and Wildlife today that they are looking at doing a ribbon cutting ceremony sometime in May, probably on a Thursday in May, to actually kind of allow for the politicians to come out and take credit for assisting us in getting the grant money.
Oh, you don't mean he's talking about you.
He's not talking about us.
Well, there's big politicians and small politicians.
Let's hope it's done.
But so I mean, that's hopefully it will be done. Also, on kind of the capital outlay front, the capital outlay committee, I did distribute this afternoon the initial recommendations on the funding for the capital outlay requests. I did send it to all board members, so you guys have it. Their meeting, they had a little bit of a snafu with posting, so their meeting's been changed to Thursday. So it's Thursday at 4. I know some selectmen have been attending that pretty regularly. So I just wanted to announce that it's Thursday at 4. The idea behind that is to work on getting a consensus and getting a recommendation for the board. And I think we're scheduled for the 14th to come in and present to the selectmen the overall plan.
Chris, should you just send that to me again? Cause it didn't come through.
Okay.
First time.
Operator error.
Could have been my error.
Did other ones get it? Did
I,
you?
I got it.
It's my error.
Yeah, operator error.
He often has these errors. Yeah.
I don't take anything for granted. So yeah, no, I'll send it to Angela. The other part is we are going to be publishing a notice by charter. We're required to do a public hearing. So the capital outlay plan for FY 17 to 23 is going to be tentatively scheduled here for January 4th, 2016, in which the Board of Selectmen, the Finance Committee, Capital Outlay Committee will conduct a joint public hearing relative to the seven-year capital plan for fiscal year 17 to 23. So that will be at a Monday, January 4th at 6:30 in this room here at Town Hall. So and we will have copies available of that plan. My hope is to have those the plan at least finalized to present to the board for that December 14th. So we'll have that well in advance of the January 4th meeting. And then lastly, I just wanted to express my condolences, you know, in regards to Dave Scannell. I've been the administrator. This December will be 2 years, and you know, perhaps a lot of folks don't know that, you know, I made a transition down here. I relocated not only myself and my family down to the Cape to take this job. And you know, it's interesting because I found Dave Scannell to be just not only an outstanding department head, very, very good with his staff, very very understanding, but I also found him to be exceptionally capable in the area in which he operated. And you know, the real benefit too is he was a nice person, and his loss is just absolutely tragic. But I just wanted to at least kind of say that publicly, that he certainly will be missed, I think, throughout the organization. Really just a great person. And I think to that end, he also, which I appreciate as a manager, that you want to develop talent so that way if something ever does happen or if you decide to retire or what have you, you have a person that could potentially come in and at least fill in on the short term and potentially on the long term. So today I did do a temporary appointment of Donna Molino, the assistant, to have her be able to kind of fill in. And obviously we're trying to kind of absorb what's happened, but we will check the job description. We will have to commence a process to fill the position. So we will be doing that. But you know, what a tribute to him that Donna, I think, will do an outstanding job in the short term, and if she's a candidate for the long term, we'll cross that bridge as we get to it. But I just wanted to make that expression publicly. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I appreciate that. Thank you. I would just remind everybody that on Saturday, December 5th at 11 a.m. at the Community Center, there'll be a memorial service for Dave. So if you're able to be there, be appreciated. Okay. Anything else, board members? No?
No.
Michael? Linda?
Just one. Chris, just following up, you and I and our Andy met and talked about how to possibly implement indirect costs into the budget, and so I was just wondering what the status of that review was and when I was going to hear back and we could present that to the board, because that would be, we're putting budgets together now. Mm-hmm. So I didn't want to lose sight of that.
We actually had a discussion on that today, as a matter of fact. Andy and I talked. The first priority, as I'm sure the board's aware, is the consolidation of the budgets. I think we have a meeting this week on the consolidated facility maintenance, so that is one of the priorities. And then I did discuss with Andy, there's two things that we had come out of that meeting that we had, Mrs. Cibula, was that one, we were going to put together a indirect cost number that is associated with public safety, and then also with, obviously public safety has a different element to it for indirect costs than public works, and then what I would consider administrative employees. So we were gonna try to come up with some factors to at least put into the plan to show people where those are. And then he was gonna put together a implementation timeline for how to integrate some of those concepts that you were talking about, the actual indirect costs built into the operating budget. So he's in the process of doing that. I would say that, you know, he is newer to the community, and he's working his way through Munis. We did get the closing done. Actually, I think Wednesday the closing occurred, physically closing out one fiscal year to commence the next. So, you know, I want to make sure that he has the ability to do a quality job. So that was what we had laid out. That was what he was reminded of today in our discussions, and that's what we'll focus on and work on.
I think got a time frame for when we'll see a draft of that. Doesn't have to be in concrete, but a directional draft.
Yeah, he didn't give me an indication today, but I will ask him if he can kind of draft something up and give a more hard timeline. The reason why I say is I think we are struggling a little bit. You know, losing another member of our finance team, you know, doesn't help with the departure of Dave Scannell. So we need to kind of figure out where we are and what we're going to be able to reasonably accomplish.
And I assume that means we have no update on free cash certification, right? We're still talking January sometime.
But yeah, the free cash certification will be January.
Yeah. Okay. Angela, do you have anything? No. Linda, be done? I'm sorry.
No, I'm fine.
Okay, we're good. Thank you.